last night, as I lay sleeping, there came a dream so fair. I stood in old Jerusalem, beside the temple there. I heard the children singing, and ever as they sang, I thought the voice of angels from heaven in answer rang. I thought the voice of angels from heaven in answer rang. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, lift up your gates and sing. And then I thought my dream was changed. The streets no longer rang. Hushed were the glad hosannas. The little children sang. And the sun grew dark with mystery. The morn was cold and chill. As a shadow of a cross arose upon the lonely hill. As a shadow.
You heard the applause earlier. That was for our babies. We have 7 new babies this morning, Monarch babies from our Monarch nursery. So we wanted you all to know that. Anyway, my name's Mike Silberg, and welcome to our talk today. And I thank you for all you are interested in these talks. It means a lot to me. We're going to start with prayer. Lord, this morning we thank you again for all the blessings you give us every day, this great nation that we live in. And we pray for our nation and the nations of the earth, especially the nation of Israel, your people, your nation. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So what about Israel? The Bible calls Israel God's chosen people. The land of Israel was called the Promised Land, and then later, the Holy Land. Jerusalem is called the city of the great king, but is it still today? Does the physical land of Israel still have some kind of special place in God's heart? Is the city of Jerusalem still the city of God? When Jesus came, didn't he change everything? Didn't the church replace Israel? Well, we're going to look at this chart here. This is all the genealogies in the Bible, all put together. And it's interesting, look at the title says, Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. This is all about, basically, the nation of Israel. You know, it starts with Adam and Eve, goes down to Noah, then to Abraham. Remember Abraham, you know, the first of the patriarchs, his son Isaac, the promised son, and then Isaac had Jacob. Jacob was blessed by God, and God changed his name to Israel. And all in Israel had 12 sons. They're listed over here, but each one of these different color groupings are the genealogy of those particular tribes or sons of Israel. You know, we're being told today that Israel, in some instances, that Israel is a nation that's been made up. You know, it didn't really exist. But here you have like 1,000 years of history of Israel. You know, Israel is an actual person. That's the main thing here. It's not just, you know, the name Israel wasn't just made up, or, you know, a name drawn out of a hat. God gave that name to Jacob, you know, and you remember Jacob's, one of Jacob's sons was Joseph. There's even a Broadway play right now called Joseph's Technicolor Dreamcoat or something like that. So these are all historical people that tie the whole Bible together. And what's interesting is if you look from here, the way this chart is set up is really neat. It starts with Adam and Eve way at the top, you know, who were really, I guess you could say, children of God, right? Because God made them. But this is the genealogical line all the way from Adam all the way down to Jesus. Okay, this is, you know, I think it's like 62 different people. And it's listed in Luke 3 or Luke 4. But what's interesting about this is this forms like the backbone, the spine of this whole thing is just skeletal framework of the Bible is just pulled together of the nation of Israel. You know, it just reeks, I mean, it proclaims that Israel is a nation that's blessed by God. He's watched over this nation, okay, throughout the Old Testament. But so Jesus comes along, right? As Christians, we believe he fulfills the Old Testament prophecies of the coming Jewish Messiah. He is the promised Son of God and the Son of David, the prophet, priest, king, Messiah promised to come. He was a Jew. He was of the tribe of Judah. Judah's right here. See? And then they bring Judah over here again. Jesus was descended from Judah. And that's where the word Jew comes from. You know, these are actual people that lived. And we know about things that happened in their lives. Okay, now some will say, Jesus also proclaimed that Jerusalem was a city. I wanted to mention that. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said this. He's talked about three different things in this particular passage. He said, heaven is the throne of God. The earth is the footstool of his feet, and Jerusalem is the city of the great king. Now, some might say, well, you know, that was then, but certainly that isn't true today. The church is now spiritual Israel. Any reference to Israel or Jerusalem in the Bible or in Bible prophecy now are really speaking of the heavenly Jerusalem in some kind of symbolic or intangible way, talking about the church. You know, this sounds good on the surface, but when you study how even Bible prophecy has been fulfilled and is being fulfilled to this day, the Bible, you know, the evidence is more of a physical, natural, real fulfillment to Bible prophecy, not something intangible or something symbolic. The rebirth of the nation of Israel in 1948 is a tremendous witness to the reality of the natural fulfillment of Bible prophecy. Over 3 million Jews have returned to the same physical land of Israel that was promised to their father Abraham and the patriarchs 4,000 years ago. They're coming back to the same land. And this is after 6 million Jews lost their lives in the Holocaust. You know, I mean, this is just a tremendous witness of the faithfulness of God. Jesus himself, I wanted to discuss this too. If you remember in Isaiah 53, there's this passage called the Suffering Servant. And it's a prophecy of the Messiah, of the Suffering Servant. And if there was anything in the Bible that we would think would be symbolic or intangible in its meaning, pointing to some type of spiritual fulfillment rather than a physical or literal, this would be it. Isaiah 53 describes a very graphic, brutal execution. where God himself really is saying, I'm coming to die for the sins of the world. We would think, well, that it certainly can't be real. God isn't going to do that. But that's what Jesus' death on the cross and his suffering, that's what it points to. That's what it fulfills. It shows a very natural and literal fulfillment to Bible prophecy. And that's something vague, you know, and esoteric. It's a very real and vivid fulfillment to Bible prophecy. Now, even though most Jews, even today, have not entered into the new covenant in Christ and come to believe in him, it is still true that salvation is from the Jews. This is what Jesus said. So it is not good for us to be arrogant as Gentiles or non-Jews to think, well, God doesn't think of the Jews anymore. They're not special to him anymore. I'm going to read you this quote from Paul, who many would think is the greatest Christian that ever lived. He said, I say then, God has not rejected his people, has he? May it never be. Now, in the Greek, it's interesting because the Greek says, never, you know, I mean, really strong. It's not like, may it never be. Never, you know. I say then, God has not rejected his people, has he? Never. For I, too, am an Israelite, a descendant of Abraham, of the tribe of Benjamin. And he said, a partial hardening has happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles has come in. And so all Israel will be saved. In other words, associated with the end of the age, Paul is saying that there will be a return. Israel will return to God in the sense of accepting Jesus as the Messiah. Jesus said this on Palm Sunday, a week before he was crucified. O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones those who sent to her. How often I wanted to gather your children together, just as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, and you would not have it. Behold, your house is left to you desolate, and I say to you, you will not see me until the time comes when you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. He was saying, I'm removing my blessing from you, and I'm not bringing it back until you welcome me back and welcome my people back. Both Paul and Jesus are saying that associated with Christ's return, Israel will turn to Jesus. I was visiting Israel a couple years ago. I was invited to a couple's house to celebrate Shabbat. And Shabbat is the Sabbath, that's Saturday. They celebrated the night before. This is a Friday night. And just like Passover, you know, when Jesus celebrated Passover, they celebrated it the night before. That's when the day begins in the Jewish or the biblical calendar. It begins at sunset. So the host said to me, as we sat down, we're going through the little ceremony, he said, Michael, right now in Israel, there are 30,000 Messianic Jews who are sitting down to their table, and they're bringing in the Sabbath saying, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. They are fulfilling the prophecy Jesus gave that the nation of Israel would not see him again until they say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. It is beginning to happen. About 10 years ago, I was in Israel again, and I met a woman who was brought up in Israel by her Jewish parents who believed in Jesus. She said back in the 1950s, when she was a little girl, she personally knew all the Jewish believers in Israel, which was less than 100. Now there's over 30,000. You see a trend there. The first Jewish believing congregation in the United States began in Chicago in 1962. Today there are over 400 such congregations in the United States. They estimate there must be around 350,000 Jewish believers in the United States alone. Worldwide, they estimate there's more than 1 million. Things are happening. We're getting close. This is Paul speaking in the book of Romans. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek or the Gentile or us. To this day, the Jews are still God's chosen people. Israel is still the Holy Land, and Jerusalem is still the city of our great King Jesus. May the Lord bless us and keep us. May the Lord make his face to shine on us and be gracious to us. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon us and give us his peace. And may he be blessed who comes in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
And once again, the scene was changed. New earth seemed to be. I saw the holy city beside the tideless sea.